Hello, planet Earth. Welcome to my YouTube channel. We're at 90K, my BFF Jill730.
My BFF Jill730.
I'm Preston L. Young, wishing you warm salutations and congratulations, as always. You've made your way to the Buffyngton Post.
You are invited!
So this week, we got a double whammy. We got Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 11, Issue number 4, as well as Angel Season 11, Issue number 2. I will be covering Angel tomorrow, but today it's time to talk about Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 11, Issue number 4, It's Desperate Times. And I don't have a copy to show you because my Capital City Comics did not have it today. The shipping order was wrong. Quality Comics didn't have it today because when they received their shipment, the Buffys were literally bent in half and they could not sell them. And Books A Million waits until like a week later to get their comic shipments in where I live. I had to go digital, so I don't have one to actually show you. But so, before we get into it,
previously on Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Harmony exposed vampires, demons, and the whole magical shebang to humans back in Season 8, and humans were pretty much on the up and up with the magical community, until recently. Some way, somehow, a dragon came into San Francisco, where Buffy and the Scoobies are now living, and it brought with it a tsunami that killed thousands of lives, and America didn't have a great response to that. And so in damage control, basically the US government is rounding up all of the demons and witches and basically just magical beings, whether you're a fairy or a vampire, and they are putting them into these not-an-internment camps that they're calling safe zones. One way that they're doing this is they are actually employing slayers to work for the government in order to basically round up these demons and fairies and all the other magical beings to put them in the safe zones.
We're rounding them up.
And last month we saw that Willow, Spike, and Buffy were all going into the not-an-internment camp. Xander, Giles, and Dawn are all safely back at home in San Francisco, but Buffy, Spike, and Willow are currently being held in the safe zone.
And so, without further ado, let's jump into Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 11, Issue number 4, It's Desperate Times. Here we go.
Here we go.
The animals, the animals, trap, trap, trap till the cages fall. The cages fall, the day is new, and everyone is waiting, waiting on you, and you. Think of all the roads, think of all their crossings. Taking steps is easy, standing still is hard. Remember all their faces, remember all their voices. Everything is different the second time around. And you've got time. You've got time.
So the issue opens up on Buffy and Spike, and Buffy is encouraging Spike to basically bite her because there are these rations that are given out in the safe zone for vampires, like rations of blood, but they are supposed to last for a whole week and there's not a whole lot of them, and basically Buffy is inviting Spike to bite her for sustenance. It's awkward and painful, etc. But whatever, Spike feeds off of Buffy for a minute and they go out and we see what exactly the safe zone is, which is apparently not Craterdale, but it is like full of just this hodgepodge of demons and magical creatures and just everybody thrown into one space together, and not everybody's having fun. We see this one like new day vamp who is like starving because the rations are not enough to feed him, and he tries to go outside of the camp by transforming into like a man-bat creature, but of course there's all this like magical force field over the not an internment camp. So basically, like, nobody can leave, and Buffy goes to catch up with Willow and see what the what is with her right now. So Willow is teaching Calliope, the Wiccan that she got, like, all involved with magic, how to, like, conjure fire, and they seem to be a little, like, super flirty. So we find out that there's this ogre who has, like, this band of demons in the not an internment camp, who is basically trying to bully people out of their rations so as to protect them in the internment camp. That's not an internment camp, it's just a safe zone. And Buffy does not like that. She doesn't like seeing these lesser beings being bullied by these super powerful ones, and so she steps in and handles that shit. But Buffy almost got her ass totally kicked because she's been feeding Spike her blood just recently, and she's kind of out of it, and when she tries to talk to Willow about it, basically Willow is saying, you can't keep feeding Spike like this, because in here, if you're not at your top strength, these demons are gonna probably fucking kill you. So after the fight, Spike gets his rations, and about a week later, we pick up with Buffy, and she's going to have a phone call with Dawn. And from Dawn, we find out that things on the outside are, like, getting back to normal, but they're also pretty weird, because, like, basically, all of the humans are super glad that, you know, their kind are no longer around in the real world. And we find out that Xander, in his defense of Wiccans, has gotten into like 3 fights with people, and we also find out that the lawyers that they've employed to kind of help Buffy can't get Buffy out right now, but the safe zones are only temporary, and it could be like less than a year before Buffy gets out, but really we don't know when she's going to get out. Dawn is just like, meh. So while Buffy is on the phone with Dawn, there is this demon who is basically speaking out, like calling to action everybody in the internment camp, the safe zone, because like they're not all being treated the way that they need to be treated. They all have special needs. They're not all from the same like hell dimension. And the situation is really bad and the circumstances are really bad. And basically, Buffy can't ignore this and she cuts her phone call short to go and defend this demon guy, because basically the ogre and his whole crew of like prison gang are trying to beat up this demon guy. So Buffy goes in trying to defend this demon guy's honor or whatever, and she starts like handling it. Well then, all of a sudden, Buffy's not quite handling it. Spike hears that the Slayer is in a fight, and he has just finished, like, the very last of his week-long rations, which are, by the way, not a lot, and so he goes running off to defend Buffy, even though the sun has not really set yet, which is, like, hey, honorable. So basically, Spike comes into this fight, and he goes hard as a motherfucker. He's flipping this demon, killing this demon, and then he grabs this Cyclops guy and just starts eating him and like taking all of his blood, and he's going crazy. Buffy gets Spike out of the fray and she's like, hey dude, you almost totally lost it out there. You've got to let me know when you're starving because I can feed you. And Spike doesn't want to like feed off of Buffy, but she says it's necessary because if you lose your cool in here, you might attack a guard, you might attack one of the Slayers, and they'll fucking dust you. But he says, you know, there's no, like, other plan. There's no way that I can live off of these rations, and there's no way that I can keep from starving unless you've got a better idea. And so Buffy goes to talk to Jordan and the other Slayer who are outside of the camp that are, like, the camp guards. And she says, look, I'm not going to sit here and, like, be a guard like you guys. I'm not going to stand up for this thing I don't believe in. But I will, on the inside, be a trustee so that I can get extra rations for Spike. And so Buffy comes back in and sees Spike, and Spike is like, oh, I see what you did there. And Buffy is a prison trustee now. And that's how we end the issue. George's Genty is back. Oh, I really love George's Genty's interpretation of Buffy. He does a much better Spike, I feel, than Rebecca Isaacs, and I'm not the biggest fan of his art overall in comparison to Rebecca Isaacs, but like when I think about Buffy, I don't even think about the show anymore. I think about George's Genty's art from season 8 and season 9, and it just felt like I was coming home in this issue. Like, again, the art is not spectacular, but it's so familiar, and I'm a big fan of season 8, and I like season 9, and so it really did feel like coming home to see George's interpretation of Buffy and the other characters, especially like Willow and whatnot, and Dawn. Dawn looks great here too, so everything looks pretty good. It doesn't look as kind of flashy and colorful as Rebecca Isaacs' interpretation of the characters, but It just, again, it felt really good to get back into the George's Gente idea of what these characters look like. And so, in this issue, we have a few things going on. We have Willow, who is kind of flirting with Calliope, even though she insists that it's not flirting because Calliope has somebody waiting for her outside at home. But, you know, the thing about it is, like, they're all stuck in this kind of prison system, and when you're in prison, like, maybe your romantic leanings change a little bit. And they are all in this like super dire circumstance. And so it's on the one hand kind of nice to see Willow connecting with Calliope, but at the same time, it's sad at the same because, you know, they're just kind of stuck together and you will kind of develop feelings for the people that you're just kind of stuck with. And so it's not great, but at the same time, it's nice that Willow is finding people that she can kind of lean on in this situation. And I've always really liked the way that George's Gente draws Willow, and so it was really nice. And he puts these, like, mannerisms into the characters that are really fun. Like, especially with Willow, like, I'm looking at the scene right now where she's kind of, like, pulling her hair back. He has this physicality to his art that I feel like really brings it home and makes it feel homey. We have no Xander, we have no Giles, but we do have Dawn, who also looks good. I really like his interpretation of Dawn as well. And we're finding out that people are very happy to not have the demons and the slayers and the fairies and whatever the heck else might be, like, out there creeping in the world. Like, we see that they're pretty happy about not having them around anymore. And, Dawn did mention that they've hired lawyers. Again, I don't know if it's Wolfram and Hart or not. Probably not, because I'm sure she would have said it's Wolfram and Hart. But Dawn is doing what she can to try and help Buffy, which admittedly is not a lot, but she's trying. I love seeing Buffy stand up for the demon rights. They're not being treated humanely, and sure, they're not humane, but the different demons do all have different needs and necessities. They come from different environments. And this one demon guy, he says, you know, they've got the water breathers in, like, above ground pools. Like, they're not really treating the inmates the way that they should. And we also find out that there's this whole, like, prison industrial complex situation going on because they have, like, workers. They have people going out and doing, like, manual labor, which is kind of fucked up. Like, I don't know if you guys watch Orange is the New Black, but Buffy's now tackling the prison industrial complex. And I will say, the beginning of this issue really kind of made me feel really bad, and it brings into light, like, all of the problems with Buffy and Spike's relationship, which is, if you guys want to go off and live in the woods together away from everybody, he's gonna have to feed off of you. And in this issue, it's really nice to have Buffy saying, yeah, I realize that you're going to make me weaker, but it's up to me. I'm the only one who really can make you stronger. And so I like that Buffy is giving of herself, but I also really like that Spike is saying you can't keep giving so much of yourself because, like Willow says, she could really die if she gives too much of her blood to Spike. Like, she needs to be vital and strong. Especially now that she's going to be a trustee who is going to, like, keep the peace inside the camp. And as far as Buffy, like, deciding to keep the peace inside the camp rather than be a guard and ignore all of this stuff that's going on inside the camp, it's very admirable. And again, like, this is what we love about Buffy. She's not going to leave Willow and Spike to all of the crazy infighting that's going on inside the not an internment camp. Like, we see that there's this prison gang in there, and they're basically trying to bully everybody out of their rations because they're gonna start a fucking revolution. We find out that the dome, like the magical force field over the camp, you can actually still use magic inside the camp, but no magic can get out of it. No body can get out of it. And so that's a whole thing. And I do like that in this issue, they draw a distinction between the workers who are going out during the day being like the new day vampires, as opposed to the workers going out at night who are like the old vampires and other demons who, like, are photosensitive, if you will, right? And also, we've got Spike, and he's being starved. Like, all of the vampires in here are being starved, which is so crazy because, I mean, they give them, like, this much blood to last them a week, and that does not last. And the interesting thing is, on the outside, humans were really, like, about it with the vampires, and they were willingly giving their blood to vampires. They were donating themselves to vampires because they thought vampires were super cool and sexy and etc. Whereas now, like, you don't have any humans who are willingly giving blood except for Buffy. And so that's going to cause a real problem. Like, we find out that the Wiccans are all being, like, housed in 5 at a time because they're some of the only humans that are actually in there. And so if some of these vampires get hungry enough, they're going to come after Willow. They're going to come after Calliope. They're going to come after these random humans that happen to be in there. And the ration situation is just not working for anybody. And so, like, on the one hand, it's really admirable of Buffy to go and become a trustee in order to get more rations for Spike, but there are all of these other vampires and other demons who just are not going to be treated as well as Spike will be with Buffy's extra rations. And so there are so many factors going on here, and we have Buffy at the end saying, my aptitude test did say I should be in law enforcement, and here she's not going to be like a cop, if you will, but she's going to maintain order within the camp, and she's not, again, going to take the easy way out. And so what this is going to do for the Buffy character is allow for her to, like, and I meant to say in the last issue, they make a deal about Buffy wearing a hoodie, which goes back to the whole Trayvon Martin thing and everything else. And so to have Buffy go from being the one who's in the hoodie and being attacked to being the one with a badge and with her scythe saying the law doesn't have to be or look the way that it has is really profound. And it is something that we've kind of been waiting for Buffy to do, to kind of get into some version of law enforcement since, like, season 2 when it was first kind of brought up. And so that's all really interesting. And, you know, good on Buffy, but also really good on Spike, because he goes out into the daylight to defend Buffy, because Buffy has literally been keeping him alive this whole time. She's been keeping him alive since season 4, if we're really gonna get technical. Like, sure, she couldn't kill him because he was defenseless, but she's had plenty of chances and reasons to since then, and here she is, now that they are in love and in this relationship, and living together in the camp, which is totally new. You know, he's willing to step up for her the same way that she has stepped up for him for so many years, and I think that is really great. Again, like, great development for the Buffy and Spike relationship. And the really neat thing here is that it's really brought into this super gray area, because it's uncomfortable watching, even though it's consensual. It's kind of scary, just because we know the history of Spike having killed Slayers in the past and being kind of addicted, if you will, to the Slayer blood, etc. And so it's just, I like what this issue did as far as kind of making us think about what's really going on with the Buffy and Spike relationship and how really complicated it is at the end of the day. Now, I had a very disturbing thought today, which is harmony might be our only hope. Bear with me. I know it sounds fucking crazy, but bear with me.
We're not good friends.
Harmony is the one who basically introduced vampires and demons and all of magic to the mainstream and made it, like, a-okay and cool and sexy and fun. And so, since we know that Harmony is out of the country, I'm thinking that Harmony might be the only way to kind of wake up the United States. If she, from another country, can kind of grow advocacy for vampire and demon rights and kind of put a spotlight on the issue here, which is that this is wrong and nobody wants to be in this camp, whether you're Buffy, whether you're Willow, whether you're Spike, whether you're Trevor, the new Dayvamp guy who tries to escape, like, it's not good for anyone. And honestly, Harmony and the sway that she has over pop culture and media might be the only way that we can really see any kind of real change come out of this. And I know it doesn't sound great and it sounds pretty shitty, but Harmony really might be our last hope to kind of bring things together. Now, like I said, it looks like we're not in Craterdale because nobody mentions the idea that we are in Craterdale, so there goes that. I was really excited about Megan's thought that we were in Craterdale, but it doesn't look like we actually are. So overall, this issue was kind of all over the place, just trying to kind of figure out what life is like in the camp. But overall, I really liked it. I love the idea that Willow is kind of making a new friend in there, and I like that Dawn is super worried about Buffy, and I like the idea that Xander is still standing up for magical beings' rights outside of the camp. I really like this whole dynamic of how right is it for Buffy to keep feeding Spike, and I really like the idea that because Buffy and Spike are still beholden to one another, they're really willing to stick up for one another in a very real and dangerous way. As far as the emotional stakes of this, I really enjoyed it. The plot, I'm not sure where it's going to go, but we do end with Buffy, as a few of us had predicted, kind of being a peacekeeper within the camps, and so I'm excited to see where that all goes. I'm going to do much like I did last month and just wait a few days, let all of this marinate, and then do a separate video on predictions, and so let me know if you guys like that format. I find that it's easier for me to kind of digest and think for a moment instead of just giving you my initial thoughts and then jumping into predictions. Now, tomorrow I will go into Angel Season 11, Issue Number 2, which is another issue, spoiler alert, that's kind of like, what the fuck are we doing with Angel Season 11? But we'll save that for tomorrow. Let me know what you thought of this issue in the comment section down below, Planet Earth. I really hope you're having a great 2017 so far, everybody. You can come right back here to the Buffyngton Post anytime for Buffy the Vampire Slayer reviews, Angel reviews, Buffyverse discussions, discussions on the other Slayers, and more. Have yourself a great day today, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
Two young people without a thing, say some vows and spread their wings, and settle down just what they need, living on love. She don't care about what's in style, she just likes the way he smiles. It takes more than marble and tile, living on love. Living on love, buying on time, without somebody nothing ain't worth a dime. Just like an old-fashioned storybook rhyme, living on love. It sounds simple, that's what you're thinking, but love can walk through fire without blinking. It doesn't take much when you get enough, living on love.
My BFF
Joe
730.